I'm Ramon Clara at our TFC studios in the San Francisco Bay Area. Our headlines on BN. As President Donald Trump still refusing to concede, President-elect Joe Biden seemingly bypassing Trump and huddles with the nation's governors, telling them it takes the cooperation of both parties to truly address the pandemic. Parents and educators react to New York Mayor Bill de Blasio's move to close public schools amid rising COVID-19 cases in the Big Apple. And from photography to music, talented villains find ways to help victims of deadly typhoons in the Philippines. These stories and more on BA. Thanks for joining us on BA. We begin with President-elect Joe Biden assuring governors around the country that the coronavirus pandemic is not a red or blue issue, but something that both parties can and should address together, and that he will champion them in the White House. In the latest attempt to fight through President Donald Trump's unprecedented attempt to block his transition to power, Biden, accompanied by Vice President-elect Kamala Harris, held a virtual session with a group of Democratic and Republican governors, telling them that he understands their dire situation amid the pandemic.
And now heading into the holidays, you're facing another surge in infections, hospitalizations, and death. And it's putting huge pressure on your hospitals and your doctors, your nurses, the healthcare workers, and it's taking massive, massive human toll on your economies. And I know many of you are facing shortages of PPE and testing and other supplies. You need help, and I want you to know that I will be your partner in the White House.
Biden's meeting with the governors comes as the U.S. surpassed 250,000 deaths due to the coronavirus. With more than 11.6 million people now infected since the start of the pandemic, just 8 months ago, cases are still surging in 48 states. On Wednesday alone, another 172,000 new cases were posted in the U.S. Nearly 80,000 people are being treated in hospitals across the country, with 20% of the medical centers getting overwhelmed. The Centers for Disease Control and Prevention on Thursday urged Americans not to travel during the Thanksgiving holiday and not to celebrate with people outside of their households. On a positive note, after Pfizer and Moderna's announcement that their vaccines were 95% effective, the University of Oxford and AstraZeneca said its own vaccine is safe and triggers a similar immune response among all adults, according to preliminary findings. Up to 30 million doses of vaccines from the three different pharmaceutical giants are expected to be distributed to the general public before the end of the year. As Thanksgiving nears, the demand for coronavirus tests across the U.S. is increasing. In Wisconsin, long lines of vehicles were seen outside a drive-thru testing facility as thousands wait to get tested. It's the same story in New York, where lines span multiple city blocks at testing sites. The demand is partly due to some states like Massachusetts compelling visitors to undergo a two-week quarantine or show a negative test. Laboratories have warned the surge in demand may lead to bottlenecks and delays. That's potentially a critical setback in America's pandemic fight. Experts are concerned that the U.S. is falling far short of the daily COVID-19 tests needed to control the virus. America is testing 1.5 million people per day on average, but experts believe the number should be between 4 and 15 million daily. A major roadblock for New York City, which has to shut down nearly 2,000 schools due to its rising COVID-19 infection rate. Most teachers there still prefer in-person learning. But as Don Tagala tells us, the earliest schools could open is after Thanksgiving.
Just when the nation's largest public school system was making strides with a learning model that combines in-person and virtual classes, which began in the fall, New York City hit the 3% infection rate threshold over a seven-day rolling average. 1,800 public schools in the Big Apple will shut down today, November 19.
We're a little sad it's closed, but if that's what's best for the kids, we'll go with it.
It was a big letdown for Mayor Bill de Blasio, who was the first city big mayor in the entire nation to reopen school campuses.
So much good work has been put into keeping the schools open, opening the schools when almost no other major school system in America opened, making them so safe. But we set a very clear standard, and we need to stick to that standard.
De Blasio said the earliest New York public schools could reopen is after Thanksgiving, but they still have to determine standards for reopening.
The full remote instruction is temporary until further notice. But of course, if I'm a school-based staff member, I would prefer that I would be given some kind of notice that it will be this permanent until the end of the school year, and that is June.
As education administrator in the New York City Department of Education, Joy Caleb supervises schools and makes sure students and families receive better support services, especially in remote settings. Caleb said most teachers still prefer in-person teaching.
Teachers really would prefer to go back to the brick-and-mortar building because the number one concern is about engagement done, student engagement. A lot of our students don't like to show their faces. They just don't know how engaged they are.
Caleb stressed that the success of remote learning rests on a successful collaboration between schools, parents, and students. While New York chose to end in-person learning in public schools, the state continues to allow indoor dining and gyms to remain open at reduced capacity, making some parents upset. And all remote instruction will interrupt the education of about 300,000 children who have been attending in-person classes, and also creates childcare problems for parents. Meanwhile, a Catholic school superintendent in Brooklyn tweeted that 69 private Catholic schools will remain open amid these developments. Don Tagala, ABS-CBN News, New York.
We go to Canada, where even remote territories are grappling with rising cases of COVID-19. British Columbia, meanwhile, is imposing travel restrictions to stem the coronavirus spike. More from Rowena Papasan.
COVID-19 continued its rampage across Canada, with new cases reported at 6,100 on Wednesday alone. That's more than double from the highest recorded last May. The virus has spread even to Nunavut in the remote Northwest Territories, where 70 cases were reported within just a few days, prompting a lockdown in the province. Manitoba, meantime, has hired private security personnel to issue tickets to violators of COVID-19 restrictions starting this weekend to curb its rapid infection rate. Saskatchewan, with 132 new cases Wednesday, will start mandatory masking effective tomorrow, while Ontario is expected to impose more restrictions before the week ends. With British Columbia also reeling from the second wave of infections, Premier John Horgan has asked Prime Minister Justin Trudeau to carry out a pan-Canada approach and limit travel between provinces.
The people of Quebec and Ontario and Manitoba need to know that they should stay in Quebec, Ontario, and Manitoba until we get to a place where we can start distributing a vaccine across the country.
Non-essential travel within BC is also banned for the next 2 weeks, as more than 700 new COVID-19 cases were reported in the province Wednesday. The ban on social gatherings outside one's immediate household may also be extended for another 2 weeks. But Filipino-Canadian Dr. Anna Wallach, one of the doctors who started the Masks for BC movement, said more needs to be done and urged the province to make masks mandatory.
We don't want another lockdown. We don't want another thing like happened in the spring. We want the economy to keep going. We need to find some sort of protection. And putting on a mask and asking people to put on a mask, it's not that hard.
Wallach said large gatherings may still be restricted by next month if infections continue to be on the rise. She urged Filipino Canadians to brace themselves and just find more creative ways of gathering this Christmas.
It's not going to happen this year. But there can be Zoom Noche Buena, and everybody can sit around the table and you know, if somebody cooks the lechon and just divides it up and has it delivered to various people's houses, so you can share in that sort of thing. It's a time to be creative, to use that Filipino resiliency and creativity.
Rowena Papasin, ABS-CBN News.
President Trump runs out of court options to stop Joe Biden's ascent to the White House. His campaign shifts to a different strategy, blocking vote certification. In Michigan, Republicans have urged statewide canvassers to oppose certification of election results. This after two Michigan Republicans who initially blocked certification of election results in Wayne County before approving them say they now want to reverse their decision. One county in Arizona have also decided to delay certification until Monday, citing pending election outcome challenges. These efforts underscore Trump's willingness to cling to power as much as possible. The defeated incumbent has refused to concede to Biden nearly 2 weeks since the race was called in favor of the Democratic nominee. Weekly jobless claims in the U.S. rose for the first time in 5 weeks. The number of Americans seeking unemployment aid climbed to 742,000 last week from 711,000 the week before that. Jobless claims soared to nearly 7 million back in March when the pandemic intensified. The new data indicates that the spike in COVID-19 cases across America is slowing the economy and forcing companies to reduce manpower. It appears, though, that the worst is yet to come, as the arrival of cold weather may result in further layoffs. Meanwhile, in the Philippines, President Rodrigo Duterte refuses to apologize for his public rants against Vice President Lenny Robredo. Duterte's spokesperson, Harry Roque, even used his briefing to mount his own attack against Robredo and her daughters as well. Mike Navala reports.
Report first on
President Duterte will not apologize to Vice President Lenny Robredo for his verbal tirades, even after two of his officials falsely accused her of riding a military plane to visit a typhoon-battered province.
Hindi naman sinabi ni Presidente sumakay siya ng C-130. Akin siya maghihingi ng abiso. Tapos na po yun. Public apology na sila. Ano pang gusto natin? Mangisay?
Robredo says she was compelled to correct the false information that reached the President.
Basta kasinungalingan, papatulan ko. Hindi ko papatulan sa level nila, pero papatulan ko sa level ko.
Defense Secretary Delfin Lorenzana and Chief Presidential Legal Counsel Salvador Panelo on Wednesday apologized to Robredo over the erroneous claim she allegedly boarded a military plane to Verac, Catanduanes. But Robredo says she has yet to receive the apology. Robredo adds, it is Panelo's and even the President's obligation to confirm any information they receive before making any comments in public. And if there's a need to criticize, it doesn't have to be through threats and rude remarks.
Kung pananakot na sisirain, hindi ako yung nababawasan, siya yung nababawasan.
Presidential spokesperson Harry Roque is not done yet with the Vice President. Roque spent a portion of his briefing in Malacanang discussing the tweets of Robredo's daughters. Trisha had asked if an unidentified person is still asleep at 8 a.m. Aika answered, it was a Saturday, a weekend. Roque had earlier used the weekend as an excuse for the president's absence in a televised briefing for Super Typhoon Rolly. What the president on Tuesday said, he is a night person whose day starts at 2 in the afternoon.
Sa mulat mula, ganyan po si Presidente, tinanggap naman siya ng taong bayan at hindi na po siya magbabago.
In a tweet, Robredo's spokesperson Barry Gutierrez questions why the palace had to dwell on the tweets of Robredo's daughters when dozens have died, thousands displaced, and the country has suffered over ₱1 billion worth of damage because of the typhoon. He points out the Vice President went straight back to work while Malacanang was still preoccupied with the hashtag 3 days later. Mike Navalio, ABS-CBN News.
So in the Philippines, President Duterte has approved an advance payment to pharmaceutical firms developing COVID-19 vaccines. The Philippine Health Department has already identified who will be prioritized for vaccination. Ina Reformina with the details.
The Food and Drug Administration says several pharmaceutical companies that are developing their respective COVID-19 vaccines have signified interest to conduct phase 3 of their clinical trials in the Philippines, which will involve thousands of volunteer recipients. The Department of Science and Technology bears vaccine candidates from China, Johnson & Johnson, and Russia's Sputnik V have completed application requirements.
Mukhang kaunting panahon na lang naman po siguro at may iba nilang requirement na lang ang hinihingi natin sa kanila para po ma-approve natin itong clinical trial na to.
Malacanang says President Duterte is set to issue an executive order that will allow the FDA to issue an emergency use authorization to any vaccine candidates still on phase 3 clinical trial, but has already shown high efficacy and safety. The Health Department told the House Committee on People's Participation on Wednesday that the Executive Department has also approved an initial ₱2.5 billion allocation for the Philippines' engagement in the World Health Organization's COVAX program, which was put up to make sure countries, rich and poor alike, will have access to an approved vaccine.
pumayag na po tayo na magkakaroon po tayo ng advance. Kasi pag hindi po tayo pumayag, baka mangunglela tayo dun sa mga bansa na makakakuha ng vaccine.
In the meantime, the DOH has made public a list of priority eligible groups who will first receive the vaccine here. First crack are given to public frontline health workers, followed by indigent senior citizens, other remaining senior citizens, and the rest of the indigent population. The next priority goes to personnel of the PNP, AFP, Coast Guard, BFP, and CAFGU. Next on the list are teachers, all national and local government workers, agriculture, food, transportation, and tourism essential workers, PWDs and those in densely populated areas, OFWs, and students. Ina Reformina, ABS-CBN News.
A Philan from California who makes a living taking photos of babies is paying it forward by sending relief assistance to newborns affected by disasters in the Philippines. Steve Angeles reports.
Los Angeles-based photographer Madeline Arena spends her time capturing precious portraits of babies. But when friends show her these types of images, babies crying for help during Philippine disasters, she gets the urge to help. For the past 7 years, the Pangasinan native has helped collect relief goods during homeland calamities.
It's just heartbreaking seeing all our fellow Filipinos without clothes and babies without milk, without diapers. I mean, it's devastating just to see all the photos and the video in the news.
For every typhoon, the same smiles that patronize her lens become cheerful givers as she focuses her relief efforts on babies affected by typhoons and volcanoes. As the Philippines was struck by a series of deadly typhoons in recent weeks, she's been collecting more items and raising funds.
As a family photographer, specializing in newborn and babies, I use my clients to help me, assist me in getting all those closings and newborn stuff that the Philippines needed.
During normal times, she would fly out of Los Angeles to hand deliver goods herself. But with the pandemic, this time she'll ship the 8 boxes that she's collected so far, with an estimated arrival of 45 days.
If you could volunteer and see if you could find any stuff that you could get, and she shipped to the Philippines, it's very helpful because it's so much stuff. I mean, everyone's helping each other, but there's specific towns, villages in the Philippines that they're not. It's not being covered by NGO or LGO, so those are the ones that we go and deliver the goods.
She's also spearheaded donation drives, focusing on bringing financial help to Montalban, Rizal, and Enrile, Cagayan. Steve Angeles, ABS-CBN News.
Still on disaster relief, the Lamb DJs from North America and other parts of the world have come together to use their musical talents to make a difference in the homeland. More on this report.
It's an honor to be with you tonight, here DJing for a special, special cause.
With clubs and bars closed and big gatherings like concerts and music festivals banned amid the pandemic, DJs have taken the parties online.
Mix global with the gifted sub.
And some even brought in the fun for a good cause. For the past 2 weekends, Filipino DJs from around the world have been playing 16-hour sets to rally support for the typhoon victims in the Philippines.
All right, guys.
So far, they have raised over $7,000 or 338,000 pesos and hope to hit their goal of $12,000 or 580,000 pesos by the end of the month.
Round two.
All donations will go to ABS-CBN Foundation. Nicolas Triu Infante, better known as Nico Blitz, is one of the DJs who co-founded the Sorry Not Sorry campaign.
Having DJs from across the world, first of all, brings the variety of DJs onto our network and for your entertainment. But Sorry Not Sorry would also mean that we are unapologetically Filipino.
The Sorry Not Sorry fundraiser features Filipino DJs from the US, Canada, and the UK.
I didn't realize how many Filipino DJs there are in the, like, not only in California, but in the world. We have my co-founder DJ Kizza, who's over in San Diego, California. We have my other co-founder, That Guy Rye, over in Vancouver, Canada. And I was even introduced to some amazing talent from the UK, DJ Mia Moore. She's like this 16-year-old DJ that I just absolutely love.
For Chiyo Infante, he's proud to know that even though Filipino DJs are spread out across the world, they still come together for their homeland.
To know that we're even doing just our part makes me feel happy. It makes me feel complete, and it makes me feel fulfilled.
The next Sorry Not Sorry session takes place Sunday, November 22nd, starting at 9 a.m. Pacific Standard Time. To watch, you can log on to twitch.tv/mixglobal. To donate, there will be a link in the Twitch chat room, or you may visit abscbnfoundation.org for more information. Cha-cha, real smooth. Speaking of music, how does one produce and record an album in the pandemic? Troy Loretta says the challenges were significant, but the difficult time also afforded him the chance to pursue his dream of making an OPM album. Yong Chavez speaks with the artists and musical directors of some of Hollywood's biggest pop stars.
Producing a collaborative album amid the pandemic may be an almost impossible feat for many artists, but Phil Am Troy Loretta did make his dream come true. On November 22, Loretta is set to release an all-original Filipino music or OPM album featuring talents like Nicole Scherzinger of the Pussycat Dolls and American Idol's Pia Toscano singing Tagalog songs for the first time. When the pandemic began, the musical director was on an international concert tour with music icon David Foster. Loretta, who has done shows with top artists like Ariana Grande, Andrea Bocelli, Steven Tyler, and many others, shares why he focused on OPM this time.
You know, I worked with so many amazing artists. You know, God has been so good. And, you know, the one thing that they kind of love about, like, my playing is the way that, you know, I'm able to follow a singer, like the choices, just on a musical level. And I really credit OPM for that, because when I was young, I used to listen to the teleseries, like when there's a dramatic moment, you know, the piano comes in with the violin. So I always knew that OPM played a huge role in my career. So it was like a way of kind of giving respect and credit.
Loretta said he taught OPM songs to the non-Tagalog speaking artists through Zoom sessions. For those who live in Los Angeles, like Scherzinger, they used strict pandemic safety protocols and recorded in Loretta's house.
It's the first time she sang in Tagalog, so it was such an honor to be able to connect that together, you know, finally.
Also in the album is his sister Chessa, who was a finalist on the second season of The Voice, as well as Asia's songbird Regine Velasquez and Jake Cyrus, the artist formerly known as Therese Pempenko. Loretta credited Cyrus for hiring him as a musical director in his tours, as well as David Foster for mentoring him.
Do these shows and tours with these artists, I always imagine, like, wow, like, what if I could give the same energy, this type of stuff, to Filipino music? So Kaibigan is just my way of bringing the world to play Filipino music. So when you hear it, you'll hear, like, the influences from, you know, from New York, from Detroit, from Los Angeles, and you'll hear it infused with, like, the base of, you know, of Filipino music.
Loretta's album will be released on all digital music platforms such as iTunes and Spotify. Yong Chavez, ABS-CBN News, here in Hollywood.
And that's it for BA this Thursday, November 19th. You may also catch our stories on our website, balitangamerica.tv, as well as on our Twitter and Facebook pages. I'm Ramon Clara. Until tomorrow, stay safe, Captain America.